Good evening and welcome to a public discussion hosted by the Bulgarian Fulbright Commission and Columbia University School of International and Public Affairs. The topic tonight is the refugee crossroads, Europe's crisis, international best practices, and Bulgaria's role in humanitarian assistance. While the overarching theme of tonight's discussion is a somber one, the migration crisis, we also have a more pleasant reason for gathering together this evening. 2016 marks the 70th anniversary of both the Fulbright program and the Columbia School of International and Public Affairs. Both institutions were founded in 1946 as a response to one of the greatest crises of the 20th century, World War II. In the aftermath of that war, Senator J. William Fulbright, a Democrat from Arkansas, proposed a massive program for international exchange, seeing educational exchange and cultural diplomacy as a crucial way to build mutual understanding among the peoples of the world. As Senator Fulbright put it, quote, "The simple purpose of the exchange program is to erode the culturally rooted mistrust that sets nations against one another. The exchange program is not a panacea, but an avenue of hope," end quote. Similarly, Columbia University School of International Affairs was also founded in 1946 to educate new generations of leaders able to take on the critical public policy challenges facing the global community. SIPA is an exceptionally international in terms of its student body and orientation. Today, nearly half of SIPA's 1,200 students are from outside the United States, and the school's 18,000 alumni work in more than 150 nations around the globe. And tonight, we'll hear from one of SIPA's alumni, Dr. Philip Gounev, who's currently Deputy Minister of the Interior here in Bulgaria. We'll also have the opportunity to witness SIPA's research process in action as we hear from Dr. Robin Brooks and her students on their research findings. We hope that tonight's discussion, which brings together Fulbright alumni with SIPA faculty and students, will contribute to both institutions' missions to further mutual understanding and to open new avenues of hope. I'm honored to introduce our first speaker tonight, Dr. Philip Gounev. Philip Gounev is Deputy Minister of the Interior, where his portfolio includes migrant and refugee issues. He holds a bachelor's degree in business administration from Eastern Nazarene College, a master's degree in social anthropology from the London School of Economics, and a master's degree in international affairs from the School of International and Public Affairs at Columbia University, where he was on a Fulbright scholarship. In 2011, he obtained a PhD in sociology from the London School of Economics. Since 2012, he has served as a member of the European Commission's expert group on corruption. Dr. Gounev?
Thank you very much. I'm quite happy to be here tonight. I think 15 years ago when I was at SIPA, I did a similar consultancy then for the UNDP in Bulgaria. We came a group of SIPA students to on the Millennium Development Goals. I have to say, I don't think any of them have been achieved. No one took into consideration our recommendations then, which is helpful because now we have to struggle with exactly the same issues that we did when we came 15 years ago. The issue of migration, I have to admit, although my PhD was on criminal migration, and I spent quite a bit of time studying migration patterns in Europe, what we face today is something completely different. And I've never seen, and I spent many years working for the European Commission as a consultant, but I've never seen the European Commission so much at loss in terms of what kind of policies they should recommend, what should be the way forward, such lack of leadership across Europe, which normally we've seen on many issues over the years, that the German government or the French government or any of the big countries would take leadership in leading policies, or at least behind the scenes push the Commission in certain direction. Here there is very little political guidance. In the past 2 years we are witnessing the same conversations over and over again at high-level meetings, at the Prime Minister's Council meetings or at the Interior Minister's meetings. And it's also helped us, Bulgaria, for normally since 2007 when it became member of the European Union, on many issues there wasn't even a need for a national position or to defend the national interest, because European led the things in some direction, and then all the countries or the European Commission and led it, and everyone followed. And now we're in a position where almost on a weekly basis we need to take a strong position in how the migration or border security policies should go. And we've been hosting quite a few high-level meetings and drawn attention from various political circles and policy circles in Europe because we're in the front lines. And our position as a, what many European countries perceive as a, as the front lines of the migration crisis has put us in a situation where we have to know what Europe's interest is, how we can defend the European interest, and where the Bulgarian interest fits into all this. And it's unfortunately, as a small country, we have very limited capacity, expert capacity to deal with such issues, and any help, including the type proposed by the, like the one you provided to the State Agency for Refugees, is normally quite welcome, and we even discussed sort of future ways in which external help with the humanitarian law or other aspects could be provided. I just wanted to draw your attention to kind of the types of dilemmas that we face in order to design policy responses, both on border security and asylum and migration policies. The two for us are interrelated. The European Commission, and normally much attention is paid to the asylum system, to the migration policies. On the other hand, they expect certain level of border security standards to be kept, which hasn't taken place, and hence the criticism and the reaction towards Greece. But I think I've seen over the past year and a half change in the mindset of various policymakers. About a year, we had here a presidential debate of presidents from, and former and current presidents from across Europe, discussing the migration crisis. These were presidents that are, Bulgaria doesn't have the president is not the executive power, but it's more of a representative. So they're very much at ease to take high moral grounds when discussing the migration crisis and speaking broadly about human rights, and not necessarily face the policy dilemmas that we face on a daily basis. And my impression was that it was very easy for the people who don't have to ask themselves the practical questions that the governments across Europe have to make. It was very easy to take these high moral grounds, and some of them try to continue to make it, but it's a diminishing minority once, because more and more people come to realize how complicated the situation is, how different the political map across Europe is, and how many different interests have to be met in order to come up with workable policy solutions. First, I think the first realization, which it came especially after the Paris attacks, but it was it made it obvious during the Paris attacks. Our experience from the past year and a half has the issue of security and migration. It's very difficult to put aside. We kept saying that because we are one of the few countries that uses a very similar screening model for migrants as the United States, we come across dangerous people on a monthly basis. And I've had high-level meetings with Frontex and with other European agencies who dismissed such allegations as kind of anti-migrant speak and so forth. But nowadays, and especially in the past 4 months, there was growing evidence that naturally terrorist and criminal networks are taking advantage of the existing smuggling channels and open migrant routes. And this put on the agenda the whole dilemma of security and migration, which I think more and more countries are now realizing and thinking about policy responses. The other big dilemma, which also gradually took place, was about financial realities and capacities of what countries can do. The finance, the Finnish minister, the Finnish prime minister invited people to his house, but yeah, he invited the first 10 people, and then several months later he said, well, no more, Finland was up to here. And this reality of how many people Europe can and European countries can accommodate, how many people can we really help, our prime minister is pushing for kind of putting a quota, like the US said, we'll accept that many people. These are questions that more and more countries are. Austria was the first one a few months ago to formally put a quota, and of course everyone said, well, that's really illegal. But that just opens the question of to what extent the Geneva Convention and the rights guaranteed there really can work today. And more people are now starting to try to interpret the Geneva Convention in ways that I'm not sure can be acceptable, are acceptable, but already thinking about ways to maybe what kind of international legal order we need to deal with this situation. The same thing with financial and kind of social realities that we face and the migration crisis. In the beginning, many countries were quite open to offer significant financial assistance to refugees. European legislation suggests that we should provide them with identical or similar social packages. But at the same time, this comes into conflict with the perceived quota system that they want to enforce. And in Bulgaria, no one can survive on 50 euros a day, but yet that's what the social assistance package for Bulgarian grandmothers is. There are 1.5 million Bulgarians living on 100 euros per month. How do we square this with sharing responsibility amongst European countries, and who will really ever want to stay in poor European countries, and what can Western European countries really afford to pay to newcomers, and are their social package systems able to take? They were able to take the first million, but now very few are able to take the second million. And the long-term costs, as some institutes are starting to calculate, are humongous. In Germany, I think they assessed that it's in about 100 billion over the next, whatever, 10, 20 years. These dilemmas, of course, first come in clash with the rights that both the international legislation, the domestic and the European legislation is trying to provide to migrants. And I think it's still very difficult for countries to decide whether they want to respect these international obligations, whether they want to change them. And I think that's where we go in a circle at these European Council meetings, and tomorrow I don't see any hope for any change, because these dilemmas, there hasn't been really the only parties that suggest any workable solutions are the far right parties, who just say, yeah, we should just stop everyone and not allow them. But the others are just struggling to formulate policies and to formulate things that respond to the current international legislation. That was my short introduction on the things that I'm going through on a daily basis, and I look forward to listening to the discussion today. Thanks.